Hey guys, Savinator5000 with a video for you about cartridges. Whole bunch of cartridges. These pretty much shaped gaming to what it is today. Without them, we can't play the games, so... Well, we just had the console, nothing to do with it. So, I thought maybe we'll give an honor to some of the more well-known ones, like Nintendo's and Sega's. And I want to show you the evolution from this baby all the way to this guy. A big difference, really. So I think we should take it slow and start here with the NES. Alright, so the NES cartridge was released in 1986 with the NES. And it was a very interesting design. It was almost more like a toy because, well, the video game crash happened and people didn't want to buy video games. So, the original design was very complicated with wireless printer and wireless keyboard and controllers and guns and all sorts of weird stuff. But they opted in the end for a more simplistic design, which is, I think, better for them. Because I think without it, video games weren't the same as they are today. Yeah, as you can see, it's very big and pretty much for no reason, because the actual game is more like over here only. Like this, all of this area is dead. So yeah, the front of it, you got your label, your little edges here, ridges, so you can, for no real reason really. It's to look like the NES, which also had ridges like that for ventilation, but this doesn't need ventilation. It's not the virtual eraser. Yeah, over here you got your front label, and a little area here to pinch, because what happens, you push it down into the NES to play, and then you need to take it out, so force it out like this. It's not complicated. On the back, you got your warning and three screws. Some games had three, some had five, some cartridges of the same game had different amounts. I don't want to get into that today. Yeah, that's the security screws, not simple screws. They don't want you to open it. So yeah, you're kind of screwed if your game has problems. Oh, you can open it with no problem, really. And you got your pins to connect to the system. So yeah, that's the NES cartridge. It's a very interesting design. Needlessly bulky and big. But I guess that's for little kids to, you know, not to break it, because you know how many CDs end up broken today? A lot. So yeah, I think we need to thank the NES cartridge for really making gaming what it is today. Alright, so the next cartridge we have today is from 1989 for the Game Boy. These are the Game Boy cartridges. They were released for the Game Boy, obviously, and they were pretty impressive for their time because their size is tiny. Look at it compared to the NES cartridge. It's nothing. It's very, very small. Yeah, you got your label on the front, and that's pretty much it. You got a Game Boy logo above the label. You got a little arrow to show you how to put it in, which is actually more important than they did on the NES. But that's pretty much it. You got little ridges on the sides. And on the back, you got one security screw. And on the bottom, you obviously got your pins to connect up to your machine. Well, one interesting thing you have is this little notch. This notch is actually meant to make sure you won't take it out during gameplay, because the original Game Boy, when it's open, to open it, it will need to lock a game in here with a little plastic rod, we'll say. And you can't take it out. That's also why the Game Boy Color games won't enter, because it's just no notch, so nothing will happen. Yeah, that's the Game Boy cartridge. Very, very impressive for the time. And really, without it, handheld gaming was pretty much impossible. The next cartridge we got here is also from 1989, and that is Sega's Mega Drive. They also had their Master System beforehand, but that wasn't a big success, except for in Europe, but I don't have a Master System, so we're taking a look at the Mega Drive, or Genesis, or whatever you want to call it. Firecore, no, don't call it Firecore. But that's the cartridge. It's 16-bit, which is like twice the bits, so obviously it's twice the fun. But it's much smaller, which actually doesn't mean the NES was insufficient or anything. because all this is plastic. So it's was a lot of just empty space. So yeah, that's pretty much actually the amount of area that the NES cartridge would fit, use. Yeah, it's a very small cartridge, very light, but they can store some pretty impressive games on it. You got the label here on the front with your end label on the top. In the back you got your Sega logo. It's black, so it's a little hard to tell, but Sega logo and two screws, security screws obviously allows, and a little ridge here to take the game out. It is top loading, so it's much nicer than having to take it out to blow on it and everything. You don't actually need to blow on it. It's not really responsible for problems most of the times. Yeah, you got your, obviously, your pins on the bottom. And little notches here, I believe these are for PAL to, some of these, not this one particularly, I think, had like notches here, so you won't be able to fit in an American Genesis or whatnot. Not entirely sure, don't take my word for it. Yeah, very small cartridge, very impressive, and I like the black on it, I think it looks excellent. Alright, so the next cartridge here is from 1991, that is the Super Nintendo. It is larger than the Genesis one, or Mega Drive. Definitely larger, but it does have more stuff on it, it is more advanced, like sound chips and whatnot. And, well, generally it's still not bad in size. It looks bigger in picture than it is in real life. Yeah, you got your label here. It takes up much less space than most other cartridges. A little notch here that is pretty much the same as the Game Boy one to prevent from taking it out. And you got two screws here. On the top you got your end label and two, like, I believe it's sort of like a lock mechanism so you won't... To lock it in, so you need to push it down when you take out the screws to open it and whatnot. I'm not sure, again. The back you got your label, and not one label, warnings. And two notches to prevent, I believe, playing from different regions, which I think is stupid. And you got your pins, and I'm not gonna say it every time, it's pretty pointless. But that's the SNES cartridge, I think it's pretty cool. Pretty nice design, even though the SNES American one is very square. Not a big fan. But it's pretty cool, still very interesting, and it's the SNES, it stores awesome games like Super Mario World, and not Ultraman. Yeah, still good cartridge, I gotta say. So the next one we got here is another handheld, the Sega Game Gear. This cartridge here was for 1991 Game Gear, they're all the same, all the cartridges. And they're a little bit bigger than the Game Boy ones. If you can see here, they are a bit bigger, but that's really not by much. You got a little sort of grip here to pull it out when you need. And label on the front, screw on the back, but it has a lock mechanism, so you gotta like put a pen or something to take it out. Which is about, not a pen, screwdriver. Yeah, you know, it's cool. It was a very ahead of its time system. Backlit, even though it was from Halogen lamps, I believe, and not LED, which means it spent a whole lot of battery life. But yeah, and color screen, which was very impressive. So yeah, I like the cartridge. I think they actually look better than the Game Boy ones, and they're fine by my book. Next cartridge here we got, we're getting a lot here, is the N64 cartridge, released in 1996 with the system. This one happens to be Doom 64, and they're about the same size as the Mega Drive ones, maybe a little bigger. But they're heavy, it's amazing, they're much, much heavier than the other, any other really cartridge here. But they are quite impressive. I think it's a shame they didn't use CDs, because I know it made a lot of, it was much pricier. And I believe I heard it made a lot of developers go to the PlayStation, most noticeably Squaresoft. Yeah, I think the cartridges themselves aren't fine, but not very good, because you got the label, but no end label. Very uncomfortable. The back got screws and a warning. But that's pretty much it. I'm not a big fan of the design. To be honest, it's okay, I guess. Alright, and the next couple of cartridges here will be a lightning round. First off, the Game Boy Color. Most of them, a few of them were quite a few of them were just like the Game Boy ones, but black, which means they were Game Boy compatible. But many of them were clear and had no notch, so it means you can't play. And a little bulge here, so you can't. Well, for no reason, it just looks cool. They were clear, which was awesome. And that's pretty much it. Other than that, they're the same as the Game Boy ones. Next here we got the Game Boy Advance. These were very small cartridges for this time and quite advanced. This was pretty much even more advanced than this. Pretty impressive, I gotta say. They were about half the size of a Game Boy cart. And they were actually very impressive, graphically and sound-wise. They were really good, and for the size, it's very amazing. I love the Game Boy Advance cart. Maybe that I grew up with it a lot, but it's nice, it's fun. And lots of systems that are compatible with it, including DSs. And the last cart we got here is the DS cart. Now, the 3DS one is the same little notch, going back to Game Boys, eh? But it's so tiny, and it packs a lot of memory on it. It's really amazing. Going from this to this, very impressive cartridges with tons of space on it. And it's just very impressive to see how much we can condense things now. And very fun system. So yeah, that's it for cartridges today. I might make another episode with more obscure consoles. But I think that's enough for today. So, Cybernator 5000, signing off.